Okay, welcome back. We're on page 324 talking about where the heck do we store the user's state information. I can't store it on the PC because that's a security problem. I can't store it on the server because the server might change and I might be talking to a different server. So I need a third option, storing it in some sort of a database. So here's an example where I have an internet, I have a load balancer, and then I have, you know, three replicas, but I have a separate cookie storage. And again, this cookie storage is not complex. I mean, we're not storing an awful lot of information. And in fact, some of these are like in-memory databases, or not like a physical database like, you know, Microsoft SQL Server where you store things in a table. This one just could be just running because you only need it for a short period of time. You know, during that session, I need to store your information. But as soon as you close the browser, I'm out of here, dude, right? So very, very short-lived information. I need to store it because you might switch between replicas. But after that, we're done. So a very light load. We're not talking about a tremendous load here. It's perfectly legitimate to have three replicated web pages and only have one cookie storage server. Okay, that makes kind of sense. Okay, so page 325, they're talking about performance or resilience. And as I mentioned before, I don't automatically assume that resilience, adding more of these guys, is suddenly going to make things run faster. Maybe. If we go back to the scenario where we talked about, you know, the master-master kind of a thing, it's easy to talk about when we're talking about a database. Let's say I have two database servers, and it's for a bank. And so I'm going to make a $100 deposit. And so luck would have it, I get this server over here. And so I make my $100 deposit. The machine says, wait a minute now. It is critically important that we synchronize these things all at once. So before I get an okay, your deposit has been successful, it stops, it makes the change to this database, and then sends that information over to the second one and waits for the second one to agree. That takes time. In fact, you may have noticed, like when you're doing financial stuff, you fire up your web browser and go to your bank and you want to do a transfer or something. It's not immediate. Like when you hit the button, it doesn't just go, ding, we're done. Typically, you hit the button, it goes, Okay. Well, that delay, that's where it replicates it to the other machine. So replicating. Now, let's just say I have 15 of these machines. And then I make a deposit for $100. That means it's going to have to say, well, hang on. Okay, do you agree? Do you agree? That's going to take a really long time. It might take, you know, 5 or 6 seconds for all the replicas to say, okay, we all agree that he deposited $100. I'm going to tell him that the transaction was successful. Boing! Okay, so don't just assume adding more is going to make things go faster, because it might not be the case. And then, of course, what if each one of these machines is at 100%? Like, yay. Right? That's not going to do anything, right? I mean, adding another one might make things go faster, right? So in some cases, adding a replica will make it go faster, and sometimes it won't. Okay, cool. So basically the design, whenever you build one of these things, you really need to tell it, what is your goal? I mean, what goal are you trying to reach? Are you trying to reach performance? Or are you trying to reach resilience? Okay, because, you know, unless you explicitly tell them what you want, it's going to be hard to tell. Okay, so that thing I described, like in a banking scenario, is called a dual locking transaction or multiple locking transaction. You know, I have two servers and I have to wait till everyone agrees that the deposit was successful. That's a good thing, right? You don't ever want to have your bank say, okay, you made a deposit, and then you log back in. This is deposit. What deposit? That ain't smart, right? Okay. So performance and scaling, page 326. They talk about, you know, from a user's perspective, okay, it's two things. Does the dang thing work, and is it fast? That's the only thing they care about. They don't care about anything else, right? From a user's perspective. So you need to test from the user's perspective. You might have this elaborate thing with load balancers and replicas and cookie storage and all the rest of that stuff, but you need to pretend like you're on the internet and try this thing out to see, because that's what your customer is going to see. Okay, so load testing. Oddly enough, you know, Microsoft Visual Studio has a pretty decent load tester. You know, we just pound the hell out of a database or a web server or whatever you're trying to do, right? And then there's cloud-based load testing, which is pretty doggone cool. You can set up a suite of tests to you know, hopefully not on your production machine, but perhaps on your development machine, and try to figure out where the weak link in the chain is. That's the whole idea, right? Doing load testing tells you, oops, I need more RAM on this machine, or oops, I need more network over here, right? Because right off the bat, you may not know what is the weak link. Okay. So now we're talking about network speed and latency. All right. So network speed, that's how fat the pipe is, right? So I have a really fat pipe going between here and here and here. So I can push lots of data. But even if I had just a tiny, tiny, tiny packet, I mean, I got 15 bytes of information that I want to send between these replicas. There's going to be some latency involved on how long it takes for this thing to get to this replica, to get to that replica. Okay, so we're not talking about how big the pipe is, we're talking about how fast the water flows. Okay, in a strange analogy. Okay, we're going to circle back to that in just a second. So they talk about this little thing, a little side note in the book talking about bad capacity planning. You know, the scenario goes, you know, they're putting this thing together and they wanted to save a few bucks. And so instead of, you know, fixing their machine up with the proper amount of RAM, they said, ah, what the heck, let's kind of lowball it. Let's just give them a little bit of RAM. That'll be good enough. And then they deployed the thing and the users, this was an internal customers, they didn't like it because it was slow and just annoying. And so it had very poor adoption and very bad first impression. All because they wanted to save what, $500 on buying enough RAM. And so they finally realized, oh man, this is terrible. So, you know, they go out to the store and buy more RAM and plug it in the server. But this time, you know, I love the saying, there's only one opportunity for a first impression. So if they get a bad impression about your thing, they're not going to say, oh well, it's so much better now, let's start using it. You know, that bad taste in their mouth is going to stick around. You know, the once bitten, twice shy kind of a thing. So even after you solve the problem, you're going to have slow adoption by the customers because you cheaped out on a key thing. Okay, so when doing this, they talk about the data flow model, page 328. So you map out each one of the parts individually. You know, for example, let's just say that this was a database, okay? Instead of having cookie storage, let's just pretend like that said database storage. So you know that the database can handle 100 transactions per second. Okay, you know that. And then you have a web server, and every user who connects makes three connections to the web server, I mean to the database server. Okay, so right, you follow me? So this does 100 transactions per second, and this guy has three transactions for every user. If you do the math, you can figure out that this web server can only handle 33 users, right? 33 times 3, 99, right? Okay. So 33 concurrent users before you overwhelm this guy, all right? So it's that weak link in the chain kind of thinking. Okay. So once you find the weak link in the chain, you need to figure out, do I make it, you know, fatter? Do I put in more? Do I have a replica for the database? Maybe the database is the issue. Maybe, you know, that kind of stuff. Okay. So we really need to talk about bandwidth versus latency, page 330. So one more time, bandwidth is how big the water pipe is. You know, an 8-inch pipe is going to be able to handle a lot more water than a 4-inch pipe, right? But if they're all coming from the same water tank, the speed of the water going through the pipe is going to be the same. Okay? You kind of following me? Okay, so bandwidth is typically how much data you can cram in a pipe. You know, megabits per second is typically the unit of measure. And latency is how long does it take for it to start? When I turn the faucet, does it immediately start coming out, or is there a delay before the first water appears? Okay, that's kind of a strange analogy. But how long do I have to wait for the first packet? And that's usually in milliseconds. Okay, so one is the number of, you know, megabits per second upload or megabits per second download. And the other is how long does it take for the machine to respond to something? Okay, there's a cool example on page 331. So I have a from New York to Mumbai, and I have a T1 connection. Hey, this is an old book, but yeah, T1s are still around. A T1 is 1.5 megabits, you know, 1.5 megabits per second, which, by today, that's, I got 400 megabits coming to my house, so just bear with me. So a T1 connection going to Mumbai, and so let's say it takes 6 seconds for a packet. It takes a half a second for a request to get there and back. And so if I have a bunch of these guys, I got 12 pieces of information I need to transfer, and I fire up the first one and the second one and the third one, it might take 6 seconds for these 12 transactions to occur. Okay, so you go, oh man, 6 seconds is just way too slow. I need a bigger pipe. So I'm going to go in there and spend money and get a T3 connection between New York and Mumbai. That'll solve the problem. No, not at all. Not even close. You're going to get the exact same performance because quite literally these packets are traveling at the speed of light across that cable, and you cannot make it go any faster than that. So the latency, okay, is going to remain the same. Obviously the bandwidth is going to increase, right? But not latency, okay? Cool. There was this really cool movie. I actually have not seen this one yet. It's called The Hummingbird Project. And so it's all about, oh, here we go. It's all about these guys who decide that we can make, commodities traders want to be able to have automatic trades. When something happens, they want to be able to go, aha, I want to get my order in before everyone else gets their order in. So latency is king here. And they quite literally propose tunneling through the Appalachian Mountains with a fiber optic cable to make the cable shorter to reduce latency. The entire movie is about this project to reduce the latency to make it easier for commodities traders to end up getting faster response time. And if I can beat my competitor by, 2 or 3 milliseconds, I could actually make money. Okay? Kind of cool. Crazy project. Okay. So let's talk about latency. How do you solve a latency issue? Well, first of all, a fatter pipe is clearly not going to work. So there's a bullet list on page 332. The first one is move the work, whatever the work is, to the other side. Well, in the case of a commodity, a stockbroker, that's not going to work. Send requests in parallel. Remember I talked about in that scenario, you had 12 requests and it took each one of them half a second. Well, don't send them separately. Bundle them together, okay? And have what's called a windowed request. A windowed request means I send stuff to the server at the speed at which the server will accept it. So in other words, I calculate how long it's going to take and then only send it to it at that rate, okay? And then use what's called a query list instead of individual items. If I want to hit five, let's say it's a user database, and I want to hit 5 different users, don't ask for user number 4 and 12 and 18 and 19. Go ahead and get the entire list all at once, and then you can go through it yourself at your end. Okay, that kind of sort of makes sense. Okay, so latency is kind of a big thing in the gaming business, right? Particularly, online games are better examples, video teleconferencing. I mean, when I say hello, I don't want it to be, wait, and then it says, oh, okay, gotcha. I want to be able to harmonize, so to speak, with the other people online. Okay, so video teleconferencing. But streaming video, like right now you're watching this off of YouTube. Does it matter if it took 1 second for it to start or 2 seconds for it to start playing? Once you hit the start button, you probably don't really care, right? That's what I'm thinking. So for those kind of industries, it's not that big a deal. Okay, we've reached the end of this chapter, and I'll see you guys again in the next chapter.